Please welcome to the batter's box, the one and only Jeffrey Stein.
The original no hit, no feel player.
There you go. How you doing, sir?
Doing very well. Yourself?
It sounds like you were in a lot better shape than we were around here. We were, as you know, Paul Simon would say, we were slip-sliding away getting into work today, but you didn't have anything over there.
Nah, just beautiful weather north of Highway 20. I know Cedar Rapids had a little bit of snow, and of course you had even more than that, but just another bright but chilly April day here in God's country.
All right, and speaking of God's country, don't forget you can just turn the radio on to 1540 and check out KXEL and check out what Jeff Stein is up to each and every day. And we think nothing of doing that, Jeff, just turning on the radio, or maybe, you know, when we could go to the movies or things like that, but if it wasn't for the efforts of an Iowa native, things might be a lot different today than they were.
Absolutely right, Lou. One of the major inventors of the early 20th century was born in Iowa, with his inventions directly responsible for the radio and motion picture industries we know today. Lee DeForest was born in Council Bluffs in 1873. His father was a Congregational church minister who hoped his son would also become a pastor, but Lee had a creative mind, and from an early age, he was convinced he would become an inventor. One of his early patents was for something called the Audion tube, which was instrumental in radio receivers being able to amplify the signal so that sound could be heard through a speaker. Originally, people gathered around with headphones and might share an earpiece, but because of his invention, you could actually hear it through a speaker and sit across the room.
And that revolutionized radio. It really did. We remember the images we have of families sitting around watching the radio, so to speak, in the early days. And that would be enough for most people to have something, an invention like that. To his credit, you put a check mark over there, but not so much for Lee DeForest.
He had a much longer bucket list than either you or I may have. He soon turned his attention to motion pictures. Now, remember, the first movies were silent films. Maybe there was live piano music that was being played in the theater. Later, recordings of dialogue were made, but they were literally separate from the film. So the theaters had to match up the film from the projector with the record on a phonograph, and you can imagine how unsatisfying that might be for an audience. So DeForest developed something he called phonofilm, combining the sound from a phonograph record with the film itself. An optical sound-on-film process. He even traveled to Germany in the early 1920s to study with some inventors there, and in early 1922, he announced he soon would have a workable sound-on-film system.
Now, those public statements were important at the time in order to continue to get investors to provide the money, because, again, even back then, that's what it was all about. You had to have the seed money to continue on with a project.
No, absolutely right. And so you would have these public proclamations. But then finally, a year after he made that big declaration, he demonstrated phonofilm to members of the news media and to a group of electrical engineers. It was on this date, though, April 15th of 1923, that DeForest premiered 18 phonofilm short films at the Rivoli Theater in New York City to an audience of invited guests. Now, these were stage performances, vaudeville stars, speeches, musical acts, and they chose the Rivoli because it was an independent theater in an era when the motion picture studios owned and controlled most of the other theaters in existence. At later performances, posters offered a $10,000 reward to anyone who could find a phonograph in the theater. Exposed trickery. Well, no one ever did, because it was proven Lee DeForest had indeed invented a workable sound-on-film process for movies, shown to a public audience for the very first time on this date in 1923.
Wow, so they were that concerned about that this was just a magic trick and there was really a record player in the corner playing the sound that you saw on the screen.
Absolutely, because everybody said, well, this is magic. It can't be done. These are two different technologies. And so he put up 10 grand, serious money in those days, serious money now for some of us, to challenge someone, you know, disprove that this is really happening. Couldn't be done.
All right. People want more information on what we just talked about. Where can they go, Professor?
IowaAlmanac.com, also Twitter and Instagram, Lou, at IowaAlmanac.
All right, sir, you stay healthy, you stay safe, and we will chat with you tomorrow morning, buddy.
Have a great day now.
Yeah, you too.